Good day, everyone, and welcome to NMC1. Today we'll actually start looking at chapter 7, and according to the notes, that's plastic deformation, strengthening, and crystallization of metals. Firstly, I just want to recap on the concept of dislocations. This is something that was covered in chapter 4, but it was not covered in the context that will actually be covered today. Basically, for plastic deformation to be able to take place, the dislocations have to be in motion, or without the movement of the dislocations through the concept of slip systems, deformation would not be possible. So the possibility of a metal deforming plastically is actually made through the movement of dislocations. So, if dislocations can move, then there won't be any plastic deformation taking place. So, now what we're trying to understand is if you can look at the representations of the atoms, the different arrangements of atoms in the presence of an applied shear stress, you can see. I'm just redrawing the arrows that are already there. Now you have a half plane, right? It's not a complete plane because with the rest of the atom arrangements, they're arranged in complete planes, and you have a dislocation just below the half plane. Now the dislocation line is actually through the page, right? Like if you like to the other side, like through the page, and it's gonna move through to create a step. So it's the half plane is gonna replace the neighboring half plane, and then and so on until it actually creates a unit step of slip. But this only takes place on a slip plane, right? Do you see that? This is actually the way that dislocations move. So if you didn't have dislocations, it means that you'd actually have to break, these strong bonds between the atoms, which is was going to be very, very difficult. Not impossible, but difficult. But since you have dislocations, you can actually, create a plastic deformation or a permanent deformation through the movement of these dislocations. So now we're actually going to discuss the mechanisms of slip. A slip system is a combination of two things, and you can see here it's the movement of the dislocations on a slip plane, right? Where there's easiest slippage and in a slip direction. Usually with the slip plane, it's a closed pack plane. It's a closed pack plane. That's actually the plane with the easiest slippage. Now virtually, if you remember, when we did the planar density, we say that planar density was the number of atoms on a plane, right, over the area of the plane. So it means that if in a specific plane you have a highly dense number of atoms, then it makes it, more closely packed. Do you see that? An example would actually be for an FCC. You see that slip occurs in this family of planes. Family of planes, that virtually means that in all possible planes, it may be minus 1, 1, 1, right? Or 1, minus 1, 1. Or it may be 1, 1, 1, Or also it may be 1, 1, minus 1. So these curly brackets represents a family of planes. A family of planes, and what I've just described here is basically the planes themselves, the individual planes. So this is a set of planes, the individual planes. Set of individual planes. We have 1, 2, 3, 4 in this case, and then the close pack direction, right? The close pack direction, which is the family of directions, which is this. There's also a family, or you can call it a set of directions, but let's just say a family of directions. That would mean okay, actually the above needs to be curly brackets. Sorry, it's curly brackets. I got that a bit mixed up. Just correct that. It's curly brackets. It looks a bit ugly, but yeah, just change that. It's curly brackets, and then the individual direction of the planes would be a combination of 1, 1, 0, 1, 0, 1, and also you'd have 0, 1, 1. So these are actually three possible, slip directions and four possible planes. This would make, an FCC structure to have about a combination of 4 times 3, slip systems, because a slip system is a combination of slip direction and slip plane. So that would mean that it has about 12 permutations of slip. These are possible slip systems. So basically, it's important because a close pact, let me actually just go down here. An example of a plane that is not close packed, right? This is an example. You find that now here there's a gap, though there's a direction here, there's a direction here, but from here to here there's actually a gap between the atoms. It's not close packed. There's also a gap here, so it would actually be difficult for atoms to move in a plane that is not close packed. But with the FCC, you can see that it's very smooth, that the close packed plane and with the close packed directions are actually, within touching distance. The atoms are within touching distance from each other. That actually creates, an easier slippage when it's actually arranged in that way. Now, to further, expand on the concept of slip, in a practical sense, it's actually even much easier to explain it in a context of the a single crystal. We know that usually we deal with polycrystalline materials, but in this case, to actually clarify the concept of a slip, it's actually much easier explaining it in the context of a single crystal. So actually, when you apply a tensile stress on a sample, like here, like as you can see from the drawing, the force or the stress representations have already been made here. The application of a force really on the material, the effect it has on the material is not necessarily in a uniaxial direction. What it does is that it creates a shear stress, right? Meaning that the direction of the force is actually has components, divides into two components. You might say that there's a an x-axis component, a y-axis component. So we have something that is called a resolved shear stress for a slip to take place, right? And the resolved shear stress is actually described in terms of the it's actually just written here. This is the applied uniaxial stress, so it's the working stress, right? The working stress and cos phi is the angle between the applied stress or the applied force, as you can see here, and the normal to the plane. So this is the plane, this is the slip plane, right? So the normal to the slip plane, the angle between that and the applied force or the working stress, and cos lambda, that is the angle between the slip direction, the direction of slip, and the working stress or the applied force. So that's actually the resolved shear stress, and this resolved shear stress is important because it's the minimum amount of stress required for slip to actually start taking place. Do you see that for slip to start taking place, that means that for a permanent def I mean plastic deformation or permanent deformation to take place, you need a certain minimum resolved shear stress. And then we have what you call a critical resolved shear stress. That is actually when yielding starts to take place. So this is when the resolved shear stress is at its maximum. It becomes a critical resolved shear stress. Now the working stress at that point becomes the yield stress. So meaning that you have the critical resolved shear stress, which is the yielding stress, right? Cos phi, cos lambda. This is when yielding is taking place, right? So if you have the angles both phi and lambda like at 45 degrees, you'd have something like this. It's just like a mathematical Do you see that? So you can actually solve for the yield stress once you have the critical resolved shear stress. Let me just show you an example below. Actually, it's a done example. Now they're asking you if the crystal will yield. That's the first question. And if not, like what is the stress that is needed for that to happen? Do you see that? So the first thing that was actually done here is to calculate the resolved shear stress, right? You have an applied stress, a working stress of 65, right? Megapascals, and they've given you the angles. That's 35 for lambda, 35 degrees for lambda, and then you have, of course, 60 degrees for phi, and then you calculate the resolved shear stress. Now, after you've calculated the resolved shear stress, you find that the resolved shear stress at that point is 26.62 megapascals, as it has been actually calculated. Now, what has been given, in fact, is the that the critical resolved shear stress that is actually required to actually for yielding to start is 30 megapascals, right? and the resolve shear stress is actually below that. That actually means that the amount of stress needed for this to start yielding is in accordance to critical resolved shear stress, which is the yielding, right? The yielding stress cos phi cos lambda, which is basically just 30 megapascals, and then the yielding stress cos 60, then cos 35, and then you make the yielding stress the subject of the formula, and this is cos 60 degrees cos 35 degrees, and then the answer you get from here, this would be the amount of stress needed for yielding to actually start taking place. So, but the current applied yield a working stress of 65 megapascals would not cause the sample to yield because it results in a resolved shear stress of 26.62. And I hope that's clearly defined.